integration options and the reporting and the statistics, and we go through everything, all the features and functionality of the system.
Victor, before the lunch about the virus, you said you could add your own dictionary. How can I do that?
That is coming.
It's not yet.
We have many asking.
Oh, you guys don't have anything now.
Of course we don't. So that's a coming thing.
We're always impatient.
Tomorrow.
The Dutch.
So the way it is set up, it is set up to first create an account that you want to audit. And this is like the same as a template account, where you make the name and the profile, and then the next time you audit this customer, you can just take back the profile. So for example, if you have a portable penetrator and you go to a bank named ABC today, you simply load the profile and then you have everything saved, such as IP addresses and everything. Specify subnets, single IP addresses, or how you want it. And I'll just go for a quick moment back to the website, to the resource, and you can read about how you can specify this type of information. Or if you have any questions, you go on the live chat. Then when you're doing the auditing, you can do the standard audit. And the standard audit is designed to work against most systems. And it is designed not to crash the target system. There are some products, open source products, other products. If you run it, it will simply crash the target system. And as discussed earlier, that is because some vulnerabilities actually require you do the attack to test if it is there. And this can crash the target web server or mail server or IP address or what it is. So when you do the default auditing on the penetrator, it is designed not to crash the target systems. Then we have here the options where you can go in, you can put in some nodes, you can go in and configure port information. For example, the way it is doing an audit, first of all, when you target an IP address, it will gather all the information, just like when the attacker is doing it, then it's doing the port scanning, identification of the services, and basing the attacks. So every time you do an audit, it is very customized. And of course, the result is to give the customer the fastest audit and the best audit. Of course, the default audit, because it has to go for everything, can be a little noisy. And when you go in here to the ports, then you can specify, for example, only to go after specific ports. And we also had a request, generally in the accounts and the templates, we make some small predefined templates, for example, firewall template or intrusion prevention template. We make special templates you just can click on. And then the audit will be automatically adjusted for that. So for example, if you do a firewall attack, it will use different techniques, so it's a little slower, but not so noisy. And of course, you can still run the default auditing. But it's going to be very easy for the auditor when he's doing the testing. You can also go in and specify directories. And for example, if you have a customer bank, abc.dk, interests that are not visible from the internet. They have their own admin section, for example. And you can put this into the configuration, and then it will base the attacks for those directories as well. Then we, the next one we have is virtual host. So if you have like a server that hosts many different domains, 200 domains on the same IP address, then you can make a target each virtual host as a single target. And then of course, let's say you scan one IP address, but you put in 20 virtual hosts, then it's like doing 20 times the attacks. So that will make the audit last long. Also, for example, if you audit an IP address with one web server and it's very fast, and then you audit another one with six web servers on different ports, then it is doing all the web attacks six times. So that will make it take longer. We have here, you can set in the email, so you get an email notification when it has been finished doing the auditing. And we had a customer request regarding configuration of this email service. So there are coming some updates, so it's easier to configure for most networks. And then we had the aggressive auditing. And in the aggressive section, you can do specific overflow attacks. And some programs to discover the vulnerabilities, you need to do that. And then of course it's required to have some, the customer have some people on staff, or maybe you're there, so if it crashes, they can restart. Then we have the denial of service auditing, and again, then it will do heavy denial of service attacks to crash the target system. And why we want to do that, for example, if you have a pre-production system, you put online 2 weeks, or it was also mentioned that some customers, they have one image they use for all their servers. And then you can take this image on a server that's not online and give it everything. And then when you find something, fix it everywhere. Then we also have an extended brute force, and that can that would also make more heavy brute force attacks. I will also get to the brute force in the menu where there are more information.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
Why did you choose a drop down menu for setting the options versus a tab or expanding?
That's a good question. Also mentioned earlier, we want to make it as much user-friendly for the people as possible. And as it is right now, we have to click a lot of time to go in and go back. And we are working on to improve that, so you just get a quick overview and you can click on what you want.
Okay.
So it's already in the considerations. Okay. And then when you make an audit account, you can use it when you do the audits. And then I go to the audit here, and then I can create the audit, I can load an account, or I can put in a new customer. You can also do a quick audit. For a quick audit, that is more the most common vulnerabilities. So it's more recommended to always do the full audit. And then you do the whole process just like the accounts. Also another thing, if you encounter a false positive, I'll just go to audit, list of audits, and I did some audits here. If you see some vulnerability in the report and you don't want it, for example, it's some kind of low risk vulnerability you don't care about, or it's a false positive with a specific application, you can tell this to the system. On this icon that looks like a bug, and then you can invert them so they don't show up in future audits. Because maybe something, let's say here, it has some timestamp information or other things, and you don't want that in the report, you can very easy customize it so it's not showing up again.
Well, only for that report or for all reports?
For all reports to that IP address. So if it remembers the IP address,